Welcome students. In the previous session, we have studied the definition of measurement. So what do you mean by measurement? Okay, we have seen the basic definition of that. Then we have studied the significance of measurements, that is importance, how important these measurements are, and basic requirements of measurements. What are the things we need to keep in the mind while taking the measurements. So then we have studied the factors to be considered in the selection of any measuring instrument. Okay, then we have studied what are the methods of measurements. Then we have studied the terms applicable to measuring instruments. So there are different terms which are exclusive for the measuring instruments. So in that we have studied precision. Then we have studied the accuracy. Then we have studied sensitivity, range, and threshold. So leftover terms we'll study today's session. Okay, so in this today's session we will study the hysteresis. So what do you mean by hysteresis? We'll study about the calibration, or why do we require the calibration. Then we'll study the errors in measurements. So most of the measurements which we take in our engineering field, so it will be undergoing some errors. So regarding that errors, we'll study about that here. So we have both systematic errors and random error in this session. Then we'll study the thread measuring instruments. There are two thread measuring instruments we have. One is a bench micrometer. Then we have a thread gauge micrometer. Then we'll study the angle measuring instrument, namely Breville protractor. So then we'll study the gauges. So there are different types of gauges. In this session, we'll study the plug gauge. Okay. So let us study what do you mean by hysteresis. So what do you mean by hysteresis? So almost all the measuring measurements have accuracy, right? So their accuracy is affected by this phenomena. Okay. So that phenomena, we call it as a hysteresis. So hysteresis is a certain phenomena which affects the accuracy of almost all the instruments, particularly measuring instruments. So what do you mean by hysteresis? Hysteresis is the difference in the output reading. Okay, so we'll be having the difference in the output reading. Okay, mainly the output reading difference we'll have. That is how this output difference will have, because instrument between the gradually increase input and decrease input. So we are using increase input word here, and another word is decreasing input. So when the input is increasing, okay, we'll have certain output, and when input is decreasing, we'll have different output. So there is a shift in this output. So that difference we'll call it as a hysteresis. So let us learn the hysteresis by this graph. If you observe this graph, okay, so this graph explains the hysteresis. We have the values of measurements. So measurements means the input values. Okay, so what are the inputs we'll give for any instruments, that we call it as a measurement. Okay, values of measurement. Then on the y-axis we are taking the readings. So readings are nothing but the output of any instrument. So if you observe here, for increasing input, okay, we have a certain path, okay, and for decreasing input, okay, we have other path. Okay, so the path which is present in the previous, it's not there here. So it has a different path. Okay, so these shift in the path, okay, this shift in the path, we call it as a hysteresis. Usually what happens, if hysteresis is not present, there will be no shift in the path. Okay, so how the curve is going, similarly it should come back like this only for decreasing input. But here for increasing it has certain path, for decreasing it has another path. Okay, so this shift we call it as a hysteresis. So let us learn this hysteresis with an example. Okay, so can you observe the weighing machine here? So on this weighing machine, I'll place a plate. Okay, so I got a reading as 10 gram. Okay, so I'll place another plate which is weighing 10 gram. Okay, so 10 gram, and for this plate combinedly it is 11 gram. Now third plate I'll place, I'm getting the reading as 12 gram. I'll place the fourth plate, I'm getting the reading as 13 gram. So combinedly. Now if I remove this plate individually, step by step, okay, so when I start removing, see, I have removed the plate, I am getting it has a 12.2 gram. I supposed to get 12 gram, but I am getting 12.2 gram. Okay, so let me remove another plate. So if I remove the another plate, okay, so I'm getting the reading as 11.5 gram. So I supposed to get 11, but I am getting 11.5. Let me remove the another plate. So after removing the another plate, so I'm getting 10.3 gram. Okay, so instead of 10 gram. So what is happening while I am placing the plates? Okay, while I am increasing the plates, I have certain reading. When I am decreasing the same plates, okay, so I'm decreasing the weight of the plates, I'm getting some other values. Okay, so these shift in the values, we call it as a hysteresis. Okay, clear everyone? So next, so let us study what are the factors which are creating this hysteresis, which factors are creating the hysteresis. Okay, so first one is because of friction. If the gears are present in the instrument, if any other mechanical parts are present, if there is a friction among that parts, that will also lead to the hysteresis. Okay, that will act as a source for the hysteresis. Then we have wear and tear. If we have a wear and tear in the internal parts, so that will also lead to the hysteresis, and even by the electrical capacitance also. Okay, so these are the factors which causes the hysteresis. So let us go for calibration. So what do you mean by calibration? So calibration means it's a process of testing an instrument. Okay, it's a process of testing an instrument or equipment to the standards. We are testing an instrument or an equipment with an standard. Okay, so calibration is a process of comparison of two instruments against each other. Okay, we have two instruments, so that two instruments we are comparing the readings. Okay, the first instrument and second instrument, we are comparing the readings of these two instruments with each other. Okay, so one being the standard, so one we'll call it as a standard, and another one is the instrument whose calibration has to be done. Okay, so next, this is a process essentially to document the error of the instrument being calibrated and to increase its accuracy. So basically in the calibration, we will document the error caused in the instrument. We'll come to know the error we present in the instrument, and we'll be able to easily increase its accuracy. Okay, so next, all the instruments have errors. Yes, almost all the measuring instruments will have the errors because of different reasons. So these errors will decrease the accuracy. Okay, this will decrease the accuracy after a certain amount of time. Okay, so for a fixed amount of time, the accuracy goes on decrease. So for checking that accuracy, we need to do the calibration. So that is where it will help in addressing the issues of errors. Okay, so why do we need to calibrate instruments? So we need to calibrate the instrument because the biggest reason behind performing periodic calibration of instrument is to test and ensure that they make correct and accurate measurements. Okay, in order to make sure, okay, whether the measuring instrument is giving the correct value or no, whether the value is accurate or whether it is a precise or no. So for that judgment, we'll do the calibration. Okay, so next. Regular calibration establishes effective instrument performance. Yes, that will enhance the ability of that instrument to better performance, to it will enhance the performance, or it will help the instrument to perform better. Okay, and even it will ensure the safety, okay, during the operations, and the long term sustainability. So it will increase the sustainability of that instrument. Okay, so high instrument quality, it will increase the instrument quality also. Next, so let us study what are the errors generally we have in the instruments. So in any instruments, okay, which are we are using for the measurements, will have the certain degree of uncertainty. Okay, so that uncertainty will develop because of the measurement errors. Okay, so measurement errors is the difference between the indicated and actual values measured. Okay, so what is error? Error is generally we'll get a output. Okay, output in the sense the readings. So the measured reading and the actual reading, so there is a difference. So that difference we call it as a error. Okay, so we can mathematically say like error is equals to true value minus measured value. Okay, true value means the predefined value. Okay, so errors may be due to location. So because of the location, so if you are taking measurements in a particular area and it has much of the disturbance there, so because of that location the errors may occur, and even the environmental error can lead to the measurement errors, and properties of the object, even the property of the objects will also lead to the errors, and our observation. So when we observe the readings, if there is error in that observation, that will lead to the errors in measurements. So next, no measurement is perfectly accurate. Yes, almost all the measurements which we take in our engineering domain will have the errors. It's not perfectly accurate. It may be near to the accurate, but it will not be perfectly accurate. So some errors are inevitable. Some errors are unavoidable. We cannot avoid that errors, even if we are using the high precision instruments. Okay, if you are using a sophisticated process, we cannot avoid the errors. So there are two main errors. Okay, one is random error and another one is a systematic error. Okay, so let us see the classification of the errors. So there are different source of errors. So we group that errors as a systematic or fixed error. Okay, systematic error or fixed error. So first one is calibration error, human error, experimental errors, technique errors, loading errors. Okay, so second set is random or accidental errors. So in that we have judgment error, error in the judgment, and then we have error of conditions. Then we have illegitimate errors, we have mistakes, computational errors, okay, and different errors. Errors in measurements. So let us study the random errors occurring in all the measurements. So what do you mean by random errors? So these random errors occur, okay, arises when observers estimate the last figure of an instrument reading. So when while estimating the last digits of an reading, so at that time if we do any errors, so that errors leads to the random error. And we have due to background noise, if there is a while taking the measurement by a particular instrument, if the that has a disturbance around that instrument, then that will also lead to the errors. And if we have a mechanical vibrations, so if while taking the measurements, if the table is shaking, okay, so that will also lead to the errors in the measurements. Okay, so random errors are called as a random because they are unpredictable. So we cannot predict. Okay, so these errors. So how to minimize these errors? We cannot avoid this error, but we can minimize. So we can minimize by averaging a large number of readings. So if we are supposed to take 5 readings, we can increase it to 8 to 10 readings. So by increasing the number of readings, okay, by after taking the number of readings, we have to average it and we can decrease the errors. Okay. So next is systematic error. So what do you mean by systematic error? So systematic errors are random. They are not random. Okay. Random errors are unpredictable, whereas systematic errors are not random. Okay. So they are constant. There will be some solid reason for this systematic error to be caused. Okay. So what are the causes? So the systematic errors are occurred because of overestimating or underestimating a reading. So when you are taking a certain reading from an instrument, okay, so when you overestimate the value, instead of taking 50, you are taking 50.01. So that will also lead to an systematic error. If you are supposed to take 50, you'll take 49. So that will also lead to the errors in the measurement, that is particularly systematic error. So next, due to the equipments also. So if the equipments are not precise, if it is not accurate, that will also lead to the systematic error. Okay, for example, a ruler. So we are using a ruler. So if it has a zero error, okay, if it has a zero error, that will also lead to the systematic errors. So maybe due to environmental factors. So the environmental factors will also lead to the errors in the measurements. So for example, weather conditions, temperatures, okay, that will affect the measurements. So cannot be reduced by averaging. Yes, systematic error, unlike random errors, you cannot decrease it by averaging. So you need to eliminate the source of errors here. Okay, once you eliminate the source of error, which is making the error, which is causing the error, by eliminating that, you can minimize the systematic error. Okay. So let us learn the thread measuring instrument. So first one is a bench micrometer. So bench micrometer is a instrument which is used for measuring a thread of a screw. Okay. So we'll use this for measuring major, minor and effective diameter of an external screw thread. Okay. So what are the construction? What are the parts of this bench micrometer? So it consists of fiducial indicator, holding centers. So these are the holding centers. This is a fiducial indicator. Okay. We have a fixed anvils. So these are the fixed anvil, and we have a large micrometer. So if you see here, this is a large micrometer we have for taking the readings. Okay. So working principle. So how this bench micrometer works? Initially, okay, before taking or measuring any screw thread, we need to fix a standard cylinder of a dia equal to the screw thread. Okay. We have a screw thread whose measurement we have to take. So similar to that diameter, we'll take another cylinder. So that we regard it as a standard cylinder, and we'll fix in between the solid cylinders. Okay, we'll fix the solid cylinder between the anvils. Okay, between the holding center. And after that, we'll take the reading as R1. So we'll take the R1 from the micrometer reading, and we'll regard it as a first reading as R1. So second, what you'll do in the second step, fiducial indicators will indicate how tightness present between the two anvils. Okay. So because threads are very sensitive. Okay. So if you are inducing excess of pressure during fixing, so that will lead to the deformation. Okay, or deformation of the thread. So for that purpose, we'll use the fiducial indicator that will indicate the tightness. Okay, next. Solid cylinder is replaced by a screw thread, and second reading R2 is taken from the micrometer. So once R1 is measured, we will replace that solid cylinder with the screw thread. Okay, we'll fix it and we'll take the reading as R2. Okay. So we have two readings here, R1 by, from the standard cylinder, R2 from the screw thread. Okay. So next, after obtaining this R1 and R2, okay, we have to calculate the major dia of the screw thread. So for measuring the major dia, we have D is equals to S plus or minus difference of R1 and R2. So what is S? So S is the dia of the standard cylinder. So that we know previously. Okay. So R1 and R2 are the micrometer readings. So by substituting the values of R1, R2 and S, we will calculate the major dia of the screw thread. Okay. So this is all about the bench micrometer. Now let us study the thread micrometer. So the figure shows the thread gauge micrometer. So it is similar like screw gauge. So we studied the screw gauge in the science subject, right? Applied science. So similarly, it will have, the only difference here is we have the surface. Okay. We have a surface, pointed surface here. Whereas in the screw gauge, which we study in the applied science, that will have the flat surface. But here we have pointed surface. Clear? So this is how the diagrammatic representation of the screw, okay, thread screw gauge micrometer. And this is how we will fix the screw in between the anvils. Okay. So one is spindle and another one is anvil. So this thread gauge micrometer we use to measure the pitch diameter of the screw thread. Okay. There is a pitch diameter, no? So this is the pitch diameter. First, for measuring this pitch diameter, we'll use the gauge micrometer, that is thread gauge micrometer. It consists of V anvil. If you observe here, we have a V anvil. Okay. So this is V anvil. So this is V anvil. Here, V anvil. And a conical shaped spindle. So this is conically shaped spindle. So this conical shaped spindle will fix here. Okay, inside the V anvil when we are taking the zero readings. So initially the zero sitting is checked by bringing the spindle into the anvil. So we have to bring the spindle into the anvil. So, and we'll take the zero setting. Once the zero setting is done, after completing the zero setting, we'll fix the screw thread here. Okay. In between the anvil and spindle, and we'll take the pitch diameter reading from here. Okay, we have a scale provided on the gauge. From that gauge, we'll take the reading. So let us study the Breuel protractor. So what is this Breuel protractor? So the Breuel protractor is used for angle measurement, particularly the angle between the two surfaces. If you want to measure the angle between the two surfaces, we will use the Breuel protractor. So let us concentrate what are the parts of this Breuel protractor. Okay. The Breuel protractor will have the working edge. Okay. And we have a blade here. Okay. This blade will have a locking nut. It's provided with a locking nut. Okay. And we have a vernier scale provided on this. And with the main scale, we have vernier scale with the main scale. Okay. And we have a working edge. And here we have a locking nut. So these are the parts of the Breuel protractor. So let us see the working. It is a simple instrument used to measure the angle between the two surfaces. I said the Breuel protractor is used for measuring the angle between the two surfaces of any component. For example, rectangular component, okay, triangular component, pentagonal, like different shapes. Okay, it consists of a base plate attached to the main body. I said you, it has a base plate, okay, attached to the main body, and an adjustable blade, okay, depending upon the size of the component to be measured, this blade can be adjustable. Okay, and we have a circular plate. This circular plate is provided with the vernier scale and the main scale. Okay, so the vernier scale consists of 12 divisions. Okay, so these scale, they are marked from 0 to 60 minutes. Okay, so that each division is equals to 1/12 into 60, that is equals to 5 minutes. So one division